Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Back online again. Unfortunately, we can't get together, but it's okay. We're obviously all in this together, and it's just an awesome privilege to be able to share God's word with you this morning. So, without wasting any more time, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for this opportunity that we have this Sunday morning to just gather around your word, to hear from you. And Lord, we just want to thank you for the awesome privilege that we have to have your word. And Lord, I pray that you may speak through me this morning as your vessel. And Lord, we just want to commit this to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm sure at some stage in your life, you have been disciplined. Whether it's been sent to the room, whether it's been a hiding on the butt, but I'm sure at some point we have all received some form of discipline. Some have been disciplined without cause. Some out of anger. Some because it has been justified. I've received my fair share of hidings, and that is not hiding in the cupboard. It's because I've misbehaved or I've been disobedient. And they've all been justified. But I do remember the one hiding that I received. I didn't deserve it. My sister and I were busy playing outside. We were playing with the ball, and the ball landed up on the roof. So I know the rules. I'm not allowed to climb up on the roof. So I went inside. I asked my dad if I could go and get the ball, which he said yes, I could. So there I go. I climb up on the roof, and obviously I'm so focused on where my feet are so I don't fall off the roof that I wasn't really paying much attention to what was happening around me. And guess what happens? I turn around after getting the ball and I see my sister. My baby sister had climbed up with me without me knowing. And yep, you guessed it. At that very moment, my dad walks outside. And out of absolute shock, you know, you got a fright. And he helped my sister down. I got down and I got the hiding, which was totally unfair. But I know that at that moment, my dad got a fright. And yep, he's apologized. We're good friends. Everything's fine. But yeah, sometimes we do get punished for things that we didn't do. And I think that's just part of life here on earth. I'm not a perfect father. My dad wasn't a perfect father. But I tell you what, we do have a father who is perfect. And I'm going to be sharing a bit about that this morning. Scripture tells us in Proverbs 13, verse 24, whoever spares the rod hates their children, but the one who loves their children is careful to discipline them. Discipline can be abused. We are dealing with fallen man who is not perfect, who sometimes disciplines out of anger, and instead of being disciplined, you are beaten. But discipline, when used correctly, can be so powerful because it steers the heart of the child in the right direction. Scripture tells us that the Lord disciplines us. In the passage I'm sharing with you this morning, in the NIV, it says, endure hardship as discipline. So as you've guessed it, this morning's message is about discipline. And the title of my message is Divine Discipline. Discipline which comes from God above, our Father. We all go through hardships at one point or another. At the moment, it just feels so compounded with us being in this pandemic, which is affecting us on every side. People losing their jobs, their homes, family and friends passing away. We feel a lot like Paul when he wrote in 2 Corinthians, we are hard pressed on every side, perplexed. But as he's writing that, he also says, but not crushed, but not in despair. And now with what is currently happening in our country, we need to take heart. Listen to what Jesus writes in John 16. Verse 33, I've said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. What encouragement from the very words of Jesus, from the very mouth of Jesus. Yes, we are suffering, and things might even get worse, but it's okay. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans 8, verse 18. For I consider that the sufferings of the present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed. And in verse 21, that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage of corruption. This is only temporary. We are only going through these hardships for a short period of time. The hope we have is that this is only temporary. It's not going to last forever. There's something far greater that is waiting for us, that has been prepared for us. So if it means that for a short period of time we need to go through hardship, that we need to suffer, go through tribulation, it's okay. Because James also writes that we need to consider it joy when we go through various trials. Because there's a greater purpose in that trial. It's for the testing of our faith. So from our passage this morning, I'd like to extract some truths which we can hold on to when we go through tough times. It's not if we go through tough times, but when we go through tough times. And Scripture tells us that these sufferings, these difficulties, these tough times is the Lord disciplining us. So what is discipline? I think sometimes we have the wrong idea what discipline is. Discipline should be, at foremost, a time of correcting, a time of teaching us what is right and what is wrong. God isn't looking over our shoulder, waiting for us to slip up so that he can just beat us and punish us. That's not what God is all about. Discipline is a combination of chastising and educating, both at the same time. It points to suffering that teaches us something. It's not just punishing us. So let us go to our passage this morning in Hebrews 12, from verse 3 to 11. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons, for what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time, as it seemed best to them. But he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. So those who have been trained by it. So the first truth that I'd like to share with you this morning is God disciplines his sons. And this should give you and us such great assurance that we are children of God. You are his son. You are his daughter. You belong to his family. Look again at verse 5. Have you not forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? And then he goes on and says, my son. Yes, he's talking to you. His son. His daughter. This implies that God is our father. We have a relationship with him. And the only reason we have this relationship with him is because he sent his only son to die on the cross. He paid that ultimate price for you and for me. Look, or just listen with me in Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. You see, he's the founder and perfecter of our faith. Why? Because he endured the cross. He suffered for you and for me. And he is currently seated at the right hand of the throne of God. I don't even think we can even imagine or even fathom what Jesus had to endure for you and for me. Yes, we read it in Scripture. We hear stories about what may have happened, but I don't think we can comprehend what Jesus actually went through. He had to die on a cross as a criminal for you and for me. And he endured the cross because he knew what the outcome was going to be. There was a purpose. God had a purpose. And that was so that you and I could have a relationship with him. We are God's children. We are his sons. Listen to Ephesians 1 verse 5. He predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ according to the purpose of his will. It was God's plan that through Jesus we could be sons and daughters of the living God. For someone to sacrifice his son, he must love us so much. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. It was always a part of God's plan for you and I to be sons and daughters. Being called a son carries so much. It gives us belonging. It also makes us feel loved. God cares for you. It gives us certainty. We are heirs. There's so much behind being called a son that we should not take this lightly. What are some of the benefits of being a son? Firstly, we're able to talk to God as our Father because we have this relationship. I know some of you may not have a good relationship with your father. But unfortunately, this world is tainted with sin. And yes, your father may not be perfect. But you have a heavenly father who loves you so, so, so much that he gave his only son for you. We have belonging. We can have a relationship with our God, our Father. God is good and he is a loving Father. We are led by the Spirit. Another one of the benefits. We are led by the Spirit. Listen to Romans 8 verse 14. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. We are part of a spiritual family who are other believers. That's right, church. Other people who are Christians are your family. It doesn't matter where we are in the world, we have family. Why? Because we have the same Father, the same Heavenly Father. We need to imitate. One of the benefits is that we imitate our Father. I mean, I remember my kids, they used to imitate me. If I crossed my legs, they would cross their legs. If I yawned, they would yawn. It's just something that kids do. They just imitate their father. That's what you and I should be doing. We should be imitating our Father. Listen to Ephesians 5 verse 1. Therefore be imitators of God as beloved children. Beloved children, sons, daughters, that's you. One of the other benefits of being a son is God disciplines us as children. And that last point is what our message is about. The writer of Hebrews says that God disciplines his sons and daughters. You're not excluded.
But those who do not get disciplined are illegitimate children. You do not belong to his family. For the writer and the readers of Hebrews, it was totally unthinkable that a father would not discipline his son or his daughter. So when we are disciplined by God, it is not God bringing down the hammer. He loves us. We are his children, and he disciplines us out of love. God's discipline has a purpose. That's my second truth for us this morning. God's discipline has purpose. So why does God discipline us? Yes, because we are his children. He loves us. But what is the purpose? Look with me in verse 10 and 11. For they disciplined, talking about our earthly fathers, for they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them. But he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. That's why he disciplines us, so that we may share in his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant. But later, it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. There we have it. There's the reason. It is for our good, that we may share in his holiness. As I mentioned earlier, God uses hardships, sufferings, and the like to discipline us. But it's not to punish us. But it's for our good, and it's to make us more holy, more like him. I just want to quickly share in Malachi 3, verse 3. It says here, talking about God, he will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the sons of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, and they will bring offerings and righteousness to the Lord. He will sit like a refiner of silver. What does that mean? When they're purifying silver and gold, they put that silver and the gold in a furnace, and they heat it up so much that it actually melts. But as it starts heating, all the impurities in the metal start coming to the top. So what the refiner does is he then scrapes away all those impurities. And as that fire gets hotter, more and more impurities start coming to the top. And the more and more he scrapes away those impurities, the only time he will take that out of the fire is when he can see his own reflection in the metal. That is exactly what God is doing with us. That is exactly what God is doing with us. You see, God is holy. He is set apart. There is no sin in God. Every attribute of God is 100%. His righteousness, his justice, his faithfulness, whatever attribute it is, it's 100%. If at any point, and that's what makes him holy, if at any point any of those attributes were at 99%, he would cease to be God. As God is holy, he has called us to be holy. Because we are his children and we are covered by the blood of Jesus, when God looks at us, he looks at us through Jesus' righteousness, and he sees us as holy. But here on earth, we are tainted by sin. And we need to become more like Christ by becoming more holy. And that process is called sanctification. It's a process. Day by day, we need to become more and more like Christ. In closing, I'd like us to just quickly have a look at Jeremiah 29. And this is such a popular verse. Everyone loves quoting Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you. But you know what? There's something else that's happening in that context when God is saying that. You see, the nation of Israel had been taken captive. God had told them that they are going to be in exile for 70 years. Why? Because of their idolatry, because of their disobedience, their rebellion. God was going to teach them a lesson because of their disobedience. And this is what God says. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are among you deceive you, and do not listen to the dreams that they dream. For it is a lie. They are prophesying to you. They say they are prophesying to you in my name. I did not send them, declares the Lord. For the Lord thus says, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. Verse 11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for your welfare, not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Church, listen. They were going through sufferings. They were going through hardships. But God had a purpose in disciplining his nation. God had a plan. And we need to take heart and we need to take something from this, in that during this hardship, God had his hand on his people. When God punishes you, it's not him bringing down the rod and he is now leaving you alone. Absolutely not. He's right there beside you. He's wanting to teach you and I a lesson. God always has a purpose when he disciplines us. He wants us to become more and more like him. So the big question we need to ask ourselves when we are going through these challenges is, Lord, what lesson do you want me to learn from this? What lesson do you want me to learn from this? What area of my life are you wanting me to work on? Because when God disciplines, he has a purpose. He's wanting us to become more and more like him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for this morning. We want to thank you for your word. Lord, it's not a word that we maybe want to hear, but Lord, it's in your word. And I think it's a message that we all need to hear, that you are a loving God, a loving Father who loves us so much that's not willing to leave us the way we are. But Lord, through this process of sanctification,
You are using circumstances in our lives to change us, to mold us, to purify us, Lord, to make us more and more like you, holy and set apart. So, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, that we may have a relationship with you as our Heavenly Father, and that through that we may be called sons and daughters of the living God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, I've heard thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers, far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Can hardly think as you call me deeper still.